The American Freedom Radio Network proudly presents, live from Phoenix, Arizona, The Truth Denied Talk Radio with host Roxy Lopez. Join us here for topics you won't hear on mainstream news, such as chemtrails, GMOs, Morgellons disease, and much more. Humanity is 7 billion strong. We are the majority. And now, live from the Valley of the Sun, your host, Roxy Lopez.
It is the beginning of a new week, the 25th. You're listening to The Truth Tonight Talk Radio. This is Roxy Lopez. Thanks for joining us. This is going to be a great show. We've got several guests coming on. The first hour, back again by demand, Dr. Wil Spencer from Body Electrician, and a farmer and beekeeper by the name of Jamey Behringer in Pennsylvania. They've got a really interesting story. In short, Dr. Wil Spencer worked with Jamey and his bees, and they're going to tell the story about what happened prior to his bees having colony collapse disorder and what's going on today and what they used in order to get these bees thriving and healthy again. It's quite fascinating. Are you on live right now, Will?
Yep, I'm here. Hi, Roxy.
Oh, great. Excellent, excellent. Thanks so much. Maybe we should ask the producer to get Jamey Behringer on as well. But why don't we talk a little bit about the bees, Will? Go ahead and let us know a little bit about Jamey's predicament. And, of course, as soon as we get Jamey on, we'll have him as well. Talk about the whole thing, but let's go back to your work. It's real important work, Will, and I'm very interested in your work. And for those of you who want to follow with Dr. Wil Spencer, just go to Body Electrician. Is that .com or .org?
.com.
.com, thank you. So bodyelectrician.com to check out some of the work that you do. So how did you discover how to work with bees? And of course, I was just talking about IBD and animals and farm animals associated with vitamin D deficiency. Is that the whole picture, or is there more to this?
Oh, no. That's one little piece to a 500-piece puzzle.
Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You want a 500-piece. And it does seem to be that. And you know, I think that even The general public now is starting to realize that, aren't they? Because they try one supplement and it's not fixing the problem, and basically it's a bigger picture. And with the bees in particular, how did you discover, for instance, with colony collapse disorder? Let's just start there. Why don't we explain what colony collapse disorder is, and then let's talk about when we get Jamey Behringer on, let's talk about how you healed the bees from that extinction, really, because that's what happens. They end up getting very, very ill and dying. But what exactly is CCD?
Well, colony collapse disorder is the description of what happens. The colony collapses. It literally takes off. It leaves. I mean, I believe from my experience, the hive gets so toxic is part of it, that they basically contaminate their home, and eventually they take off. That's part of it, but they've labeled it colony collapse disorder. I would a much better description would be toxic shock syndrome.
Oh, right.
or malnutrition and toxic shock syndrome. I had a farm, and there was a lot of big agriculture around me. I was wasn't certified organic, but I was raising sustainable, non-chemical, non-GMO farm. So I put my bees. I used to have bees, and I put them at a friend's place who had a beautiful orchard and flowering plants year-round. So it was like a bee's heaven. But within a mile of his place were several cornfields, soybean fields, and five large commercial turkey barns. And that farm was not in operation the first 2 years I had bees at his place. Somebody else bought the farm, and then he started the farm up. They started planting the corn and the beans, and the turkey barn started up. And that same year, that was early spring, and then that later that summer, I started having problems with the bees. We had problems all year. And then we had...
Can you describe some of what the problems were with the bees?
Oh, they were just... They were not as active. The hive had a really foul odor, and I believe they actually... And I'm not a beekeeper, by all means. I had little bees, you know, a little quantity of hives. I had like 12 hives for my own and my family and friends. That was it. I was just going to supply my little bitty community and family. That's it. And so... By all means, I'm not a commercial beekeeper. I don't intend to be, but I have bees again now. But I don't know all the technicalities. That's why Jamey, he can explain all that in a little bit. But the hives began to smell bad, and they weren't producing as much honey that they did the previous years.
All right, we're coming up on the first break, and I think we're going to try to get a hold of Jamey Behringer on this break. So everybody hang in there. It's all good. Follow me. It's the Truth in Hive Talk Radio. We'll be right back. We're talking with Wil Spencer, Dr. Wil Spencer, and thanks for hopping on the bus with us today for a little bit of a rocky ride, but we're back, and we're back in balance. So... and Wil, thanks for popping onto the show an hour early. But you know, I could talk to you forever, so it's all good. And the audience loves you. We get requested to hear more from you. So you were saying, you know, and we will let Jamey cover the aspect of what happened to the bees and colony collapse disorder and all the rest that you're describing. Now, how did you find out what you could do for the bees? What your work is so amazing. I must say, as far as, you know, you're dealing with the same kind of symptoms with humans, pets, animals, bees, bugs, whatever. What's the core issue, do you think?
Malnutrition, toxicity, and pathogenic overload.
Okay.
That's the core. That's the core.
Now, can you explain, can you give us a couple of symptoms of malnutrition, and then what did you say, toxicity, and the last thing you just said?
Pathogenic overloads.
Pathogenic overloads. Okay. So what's some symptoms of malnutrition for anything, people, let's say?
Chronic fatigue. Chronic fatigue's one. Actually, diabetes. 18,500, you know, different allopathic diagnosis. Most of them are one of them, you know, or all of them, or any combination thereof. A healthy, vibrant, health body doesn't get sick. It repels pathogens and is able to chelate the toxins out if there is any in the environment. It's simple. It's extremely simple, and that's what I think is hard for most people to get. What I talk about in ways, because I talk about them as simple. It is simple,
right? And how do we get malnutrition? How do we get toxicity? And how do we get that pathogenic overload? Can you explain how the condition of the body becomes this way?
The food chain is the biggest culprit that we have today, whether it be organic or conventional. Doesn't matter. The organic food you buy today is severely malnutritioned. I've done the test myself as well as others. I went to, let's say, it was Wild Oats back before Whole Foods, but I did some sampling. I've used my Brix meter as well as there's some, what's it, spectrometer, where we're actually identifying the minerals that are in the plants. And the good organic stuff has less than 20 minerals, and the Walmart food has less than 15. And science is saying, from Europe, is saying that we need a minimum of 60 to be adequately healthy.
And that's 60 minerals and vitamins, or just minerals?
No, just minerals. Just minerals. Just minerals.
And what do you think the vitamin D deficiency is all about, by the way?
Malnutrition and toxicity. Well, all of it, but it's food choices. I believe it. Just like Weston Price, a dentist back in the 20s and 30s, identified the vitamin D thing, vitamin A, somewhat most of the Bs, D, E, K, are virtually only available to us as humans through animal products. And eating a vegetarian or a vegetation-based diet, you don't get those components or the majority of those components, and vitamin D is one of them. It's only the precursors to vitamin D are only in animal fats, cream, butter, fish, animal products, meat, for say, it's in the fat. And if you are eating a standard American diet, which is high in grains, nuts, seeds, it shuts off your enzyme production to even break down animal products. It shuts off lactase, protease, lipase, amylase. It compromises our digestion. And then even if you're eating the animal products without the enzymes, you don't get the reaction necessary in the stomach to even make vitamin D precursors available to your bloodstream. And then with all the chemicals, we lead such lives that virtually don't get out into the sun, so you don't even get the reaction from the sun on your skin to create it. Even if you did have sufficient vitamin D precursors, you have to have the sun actually make the vitamin D, which is actually a hormone, it's not a vitamin, right underneath your skin.
Interesting. So,
there are several components that are missing in that equation, and when they're not there, we have vitamin D deficiency.
So are you saying, are humans carnivores?
I say we're 80% carnivore, we're omnivores. Our digestive tract is so similar to a swine or a bear. On a scale of mammals, we are more towards the carnivore or bear or swine than we are a cow, which is nature's best herbivore.
Okay.
We don't have that digestive tract to eat that.
Right. And so what about all these doctors that have run out of options that are now prescribing to their patients raw food diets? And by the way, I have several friends that are on raw food diets that do not include any meat source whatsoever. It's all produce, vegetables, and fruits, and they're still gaining weight. As a matter of fact, what I had a hard time with one of my really good friends of 25 years. She's obese now from just raw foods. So what's happening there? I'm not going to mention her name, but what's happening there?
Well, you're eating. Well, what's happening there? Just in general, if the body, when you eat things, your body recognizes two things: it's either food or toxins. And if it can't deal with the food, and if it's not recognizing food, which is going to be used properly, it actually, if it can't process the toxins through the system, it actually wraps them in a little cellulite and packs them away. Usually, far away from the digestive tract, and most people, it's, you know, around the midsection, or if you get bombarded with them, that's just all over. And it's obesity is a malnutrition state.
Okay.
Period.
Right. Okay. Yeah. I agree. And it's interesting that most people that I know personally, as well as animals that are overweight, do get diabetes. They get the condition of diabetes. The insulin isn't producing correctly and all the rest, and that's a whole nother story. But back to the raw food diet, you know, it's a huge fan out of Hollywood right now. You know, for the past 5 years, it's all these restaurants are springing up left and right. And I think it is. It's just, you know, remember, what was it, Dr. Atkinson, when it was meat only?
Right.
And no carbs. And then before that, there was, you know, juicing. And before that, I mean, you know, there's just been a number of fads as far as dietary issues go. So how do I know that your understanding of, you know, chronic fatigue, diabetes, and irritable bowel syndrome, irritable bowel disorder, and all the rest of them, cancer, you name it, how do I know that it's not really just based on malnutrition, toxicity, and pathogenic overload? How do I know that it's that, you know, this isn't just another fad situation? Sorry to put you on the spot like that, but I know you're totally capable of dealing with that.
Yeah, no problem. Because we're addressing the malnutrition state. We are saturating the body. I recommend saturating the body with minerals heavily, over 80 different minerals in the products that we recommend. We also are able to pull the heavy metals, petrochemicals, radioactive isotopes, and the pathogens out of the body. So we're addressing those three issues with what I do. And when you address those three issues, you have the benefit of over 2,500 symptoms to begin to go away relatively quickly.
And is that what you see with your clients? Do you see... Give us an example. I know that one day you were telling me about somebody, you don't have to mention names, but somebody who had Lyme disease. Was that you? I talked to a lot of doctors. Someone who had Lyme? Okay, that was you.
Yeah, I've had Lyme's, a couple of clients with Lyme's go away in 28 days. And then it takes about 60 to 120 more days to actually, you know, get a good handle on the actually healing the damage.
Okay.
So, yeah, some people recover extremely fast. This gentleman was loaded. He had not only Lyme's, but he had polio and encephalitis, as well as six other pathogens going on in heavy. I mean, they were really stressing him. And so, but they went away relatively quickly. I mean, 28 days is amazingly fast. I mean, that was an extreme case.
And what was the process that you used? Was it what you just talked about with the dumping in a lot of minerals, or was it something else?
I have what I call my 90-day intensive plan, a heavy saturation of just what I mentioned. It's a whole kit. You get three big boxes over 90 days, and I work with you, or my team works with you individually on weekly or several times through the 90 days. Anyhow, at least the first month, you know, like to talk to you at least four times. But it's the 90-day plan is what I used with him, and it worked that well.
And then what's the follow-up? Because I know with you, you've been on the show before, you talk about way of life versus a quick fix or, you know, a cure. So you definitely – do you educate your clients as well on this new way of life that they need to live?
Yeah, we spend hours talking.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
More educating and sharing than anything, and because it's not about taking products. This is about life choices. We not only work with you supplementary but dietary as well as emotionally, because emotions and beliefs actually are – between 50 and 75% of your health, actually. And the biology of the machine that we live in, it fixes relatively easy. It's the belief and the emotional state that is allowing, you know, that really we need to work with more than the biology.
I see. And I can understand that. What's an example of that? You did tell me about how some people are so toxic, and I think when I'd called you, it was about my kitty who you have been working with. And by the way, you know, we're having some great results, and you know that because I touched base with you about him. But a lot of the audience might not know Harley, but Harley is can you hear me, Will?
I can right now. You just disappeared there, and I was left in the dark. So I heard Harley, and I didn't hear anything else. So.
It's okay. Okay. Well, with Harley, you know, you've worked with me with Harley, and I asked you a question one day because I said, you know, today he's stressed out. This is my kitty, for those of you who don't know who Harley is. And he's been diagnosed with IBD, and I am using him to educate the public on this as well, one day at a time. But I said, you know, he seems to be stressed out. And what did you say to me? You said that malnutrition can cause physical, emotional stress.
Absolutely.
Can you explain that one? Because we do have a lot of people that write in, and a lot of people that seem to have an illness, and it's coupled with this almost psychoticness, not to put anybody down, but they just seem really stretched.
In a malnutrition state, your body's not, you're not getting minerals and amino acids. And like I did anyhow in eighth grade, I learned that our body is built from amino acids and minerals. Our hormones, which regulate the chemicals in our body, are dependent on amino acids and minerals. And that's the basis of our emotional state. And when our hormones aren't being produced properly, it affects us extremely.
Oh, right. Okay. That makes
sense. When you don't have the building blocks for the hormones and you're actually stressing the body by not having those building blocks, so you not only can't produce quality hormones, the stress by not having the building blocks in there is more stress, as well as not having the building blocks actually in the system.
Gotcha. When we come back, let's talk more about that, how you beef up the system. We're talking with Dr. Wil Spencer. I'm Roxy Lopez. This is The Truth Tonight Talk Radio. Don't turn that dial. We'll be right back. We were talking about the food chain is the biggest culprit, you were saying, as far as illnesses go. I have to tend to agree with you. How did that happen? How did our food chain become so toxic?
It became industrialized. They knew that it was mineral deficient back in the 30s. They knew that, and that was just at the time the chemicals started really being used in agriculture. So it's, you know, we're verging, entering on to the 100-year anniversary of the toxicity and the depletion. And they know, they, meaning they, the corporations, they, the governments, they, the healthcare industry, they know that it's toxic and malnutritioned. And it's really a good thing for them because it's all a money-driven system. And they don't make any money unless they're sick. Unless
there's
sickness, they don't make any money. See, in agriculture, it's a little differently. You don't make any money unless you have healthy animals. In the human health, it's you don't make any money unless you have sickness.
Dr. Spencer, you're also bringing up something that just popped into my head about something that happened in our lifetime with mad cow disease. How did we get mad cow across the entire world? And do we still have it, but they're just not talking about it? Because when Oprah Winfrey came forward to talk about mad cow disease, they nearly destroyed her entire career.
I believe it's still here. I honestly do, because when you feed an herbivore other mammal parts, it causes a distortion inside of them. And it's prevalent that they're still doing that because they're feeding blood meal and fish meal to cattle and goats and so forth I believe it's still here, and I believe that's the cause of it. They were feeding animal parts to ruminants, and that's what happens.
So what exactly was mad cow disease, and here was the interesting part. I think this is why it got so much attention, is because it spread to humans, and we usually don't have species jump species with diseases. For instance, if an animal gets, you know, if my cat gets, you know, pneumonia, I don't catch their pneumonia or their leukemia. And with mad cow, humans actually got ill. What happened there? How did that happen? Because I think that was the beginning of at least it leaking out to the public that we can now catch some diseases from animals. In that particular case, mad cow disease and people. What happened there, and how did people get ill? How did they get a disease that a cow had?
Because they ate the cow. This is a protein issue. There's actually two good books that really hit home. It's called Pathological Protein and Brain Trust. It talks about mad cow, chronic wasting, and other prion diseases. They actually label it, this author does, about prion diseases. And that's a an amino acid or a protein issue, where we eat that specific protein, which is an altered protein because of the way the digestion happens in a ruminant with other animal products in their diet. It causes a problem with Alzheimer's diseases or chronic fatigue, which chronic fatigue in humans is so similar to chronic wasting in deer.
Okay.
There's several similarities. Don't make me say that again. There's so many similarities with that it's all hidden. It all got hushed really bad. I mean, really fast, because it's a really good moneymaker. I mean, Alzheimer's and chronic fatigue is huge. I talked to a gal yesterday that she's getting some kind of weird injections for chronic fatigue, and she's been having chronic fatigue for like 30 years. And chronic fatigue usually takes, you know, between 3 to 6 months, and it's gone. In the way we work with people, because I look at it differently. So, but there again, it has to do with the protein of the cow and developing this modified protein.
So, do you think that Do you think so? They just did a big show. They basically burned thousands of cows. Hundreds of thousands of cows all across the whole world. I remember it. It was awful. It was terrifying to watch. And then they said, now it's all gone. And see, I always wondered about that. Like, how did it just go all gone? And then I remember they were saying it was hoof and mouth disease. You know, that cattle get hoof and mouth disease that they get. And so it sort of made it not sound so bad. And then it's sort of gone away pretty much. I mean, you just don't really hear about mad cow disease anymore. But is there mad chicken disease too? I mean, if there's mad cow, even though we don't have that name, but I'm saying the same disease that makes mad cow disease, is that in chickens and sheep and other things that we're eating as well?
Well, no, because chickens are basically carnivores, and they don't. It has to do with the herbivore. The ruminant animal.
Mm-hmm.
The animal that has multiple stomachs. It's designed to only eat grass, and mm-hmm. you're feeding it other animals. That's the only animals. Like deer is one of them, and sheep and goats, you know, and cows.
Mm-hmm.
So.
They're not set up that way. And then what about humans? Again, back to some of the work that you do, because you actually get rid of the disease or the ailment that your clients have and then put them on a different path. So, you know, you just described a culture. We have an agriculture that's just, you know, lack of better terminology. It sucks. I mean, they're feeding all these animals GMOs, you know, grain-fed cows are eating other cows or whatever. Everything seems to be contaminated. Is that an understatement or what?
No, you hit that with an 8-pound hammer.
Okay. Yep. So, and including our water and everything else that we drink and breathe. So what are you doing specifically, again, and I know I keep harping on this because people are going to write me and they're going to say, now what did he say? Now what did he say? So what are you doing that's changing the human body or in animals for that matter back to the way it's supposed to be and operating, you know, in a manner of health?
Addressing three issues: malnutrition, toxicity, and pathogenic overload. And when you correct those issues the way I correct those issues, or I suggest to correct those issues, then the possibility of 2,500 plus symptoms vanish.
Now, with that in mind, are these individuals still eating from the food chain, or do they have to change what they're eating as well and drinking?
No, we still – it's still – actually, you go to the bodyelectrician.com and there's a tab that says healthy diet, and it's simple rules are right there. It's still eating out of the food chain, but you have to put in or supplement what's missing, because the food chain all by itself will leave you malnutritioned because it's lacking severely. It was lacking 85 years ago.
Okay, and so now you have to supplement, and I can't imagine what you're going to supplement with, being that everything's out there that's toxic. So what do you supplement with? What are some of the things that are that you supplement with?
We supplement with over 80 different minerals. We supplement with over 350 different strains of microorganisms, or also known as probiotics. We supplement with enzymes. We supplement with things that kill pathogens off. And
what's a probiotic, and what's the difference between your probiotic and Purina's probiotics?
Probiotic is a general term. Pro is for, biotic is life, for life, and antibiotic is against life. I'm for life, pro life. That's just a general term. It's basically microorganisms, and there's two different kinds. There's colonizing microorganisms, and we can finish after the break the way it sounds, eh?
Hey, you're hip to that.
I got it.
We'll be right back after the break, and hopefully we'll be bringing on Farmer Jamey Behringer. We're going to talk more about this. We're right at the right spot. Don't turn that dial. We'll be right back.
Welcome to the world's meeting place. American.
It's practically narcotic.
Freedom.
Oh, yes. I like very much.
Radio.
You're an American institution.
American Freedom Radio.
Welcome back to the Truth Tonight Talk Radio, and our guest is Dr. Wil Spencer, and of course, we're going to be joined shortly by Farmer Jamey Behringer. I'm Roxy Lopez, your host, and we were just talking about the probiotics, microorganisms, and colonizing and non-colonizing microorganisms. Now we're getting really deep and really scientific. What exactly does that mean? And when we're done with that, we'll bring on Jamey Behringer.
The colonizing means just that. They set up little colonies, and they exist. Where the transient ones, they live their life out, and then they pass on through. They don't stay. There's two different kinds. And most people are aware of the Acidophilus, the Bifidus, the bifidobacterium, the ones you buy in the health food store that you got to keep in the refrigerator, that's in the yogurt and so forth. But there's a whole other realm of microorganisms. These transient ones are also known as soil-borne organisms. They don't multiply outside of their natural environment. They just do their job and they go on through. And they're responsible for most of our immunity and the creation of vitamins inside of us. I mean, all microorganisms, they're the responsible parties for the actual creation of the vitamins inside of us from the food we eat, as well as keeping us clean.
Okay. And so are these, you know, I just have to ask, is this missing from our diet then?
Absolutely, because our food chain is very commercial and industrialized. Because they're very volatile, meaning they die very easy when they get outside of the soil.
Okay, so these microorganisms, okay, yes. They die, and so they're not being carried into our food, and we need that. What I'm getting from you is we need that for normal digestion, and we're not getting it, and so we're having quite a bit of ailments associated with it. Now, I do know that there are many, many commercials now with, you know, yogurt, and all this stuff to settle the stomach and just tons of it. Probiotics, they call it. You know, get your probiotic now, you know, through your yogurt and this and that. I want to bring on Jamey Behringer, who you worked with his bees. Welcome to the show, Jamey. Glad you could make it.
Hi, Roxy. How you doing?
Excellent. Thanks so much. We've been having a lot of fun on the show. Will was just speaking about, you probably heard the microorganisms and this and that, but we haven't told your story yet. So we wanted to wait for you to tell the story of what happened with you. We did discuss a little bit about what the ailments that happen with, for instance, associated with colony collapse disorders. And of course, those of you who are just joining us, we are talking about bees. What happened with you, Jamey? What happened with your bees?
Well, about a year ago, I got some bees. I got them from a fellow in Ohio, and they were in the three-pound packages. And if you're familiar with how bees are sent in packages, essentially what you have is a feeder container, and you have 3 pounds of bees, they have a queen. And what I did is I put them into boxes with foundation. I got 7 of them. And I started feeding them, because that's what you do when you get a new bunch of bees like that. I noticed within a couple weeks, they actually started going backwards. And so I went out and started observing them in the field, seeing how everything was going. And what I noticed was, it was really discouraging to me. I noticed that when the bees were on the flowers, they were not coherent. They were lethargic. They had a lot of problem focusing on what they should do. And in some cases, they're even falling right off the flowers and onto the ground. And I just wasn't quite sure what to do. And I started looking into it a little bit, and I realized it was colony collapse, and that's what was happening. In a couple cases, the bees just went. There was still a queen in the hive. There was a couple of frames of bees, but most of them were gone. Well, I'd run into Will prior to that, and we had done some discussion, and he said he had a product for the bees, so I started using it. And what I did was pretty simple, because I was feeding them. I just took and I added the minerals and the probiotic together, and I put them in with sugar, and I started feeding them. And within 2 weeks, I started noticing a difference. The bees got their vitality back. They started flying better. They started getting stronger. They were bringing in more nectar. They were bringing in more pollen. And everything started looking really healthy. And within another month from that, I was putting more boxes on. And I was very pleased with the results. Another thing that was happening was we was having a problem with the yellow jackets attacking them because they were in a weakened state. And within a few weeks after that month, they were actually throwing the yellow jackets out and away from the entrance of their colony. And I thought that was pretty amazing. Within another 2 to 3 weeks after that, I started having problems with them wanting to swarm. So it was quite a turnaround. So I took a couple of splits off of those, and it made up for the ones I lost. And I just kept the product to them, and they did really well last year. The hives that I brought into spring, I was able to split, and it was just a tremendous amount of bees. The brood patterns were perfect. The queen was doing her job. All stages of development looked good. Everything was in check, and there was no foul odor. I didn't have to use any pharmaceuticals, and that was what was amazing to me, because usually by then I had to usually use terramycin or fumigil B, or depending what the problem is, I would have had to have dipped into that, but I didn't have to at all. So we split and we added more, and I sent some down with Will, and, well, microorganisms, they work. They do a really good job. I'm very pleased with the results, and I'm really waiting to see what this fall brings, because it'll be just about, we'll be coming into the end of the second year there. So it's an exciting time. And
wow. I appreciate that. You know, for those who don't know about bees, you're doing a really good job of explaining. I can kind of envision what you're talking about for those of us who don't raise bees. So the bees went from basically very, very sick, lethargic, and dying, and a very sick hive with an odor of probably nasty odor. Excuse me, probably equates to you'd probably lose them all eventually. And then, like you say, you have these, I think you said wasps attacking them.
Yes, yellow jackets
attacking them. And now, basically, your bees have turned around and said, hey, get out of here. And those other, those yellow jackets have split, gone on their merry way. And then now it sounds like your hives have split, which means they multiplied. I guess that's what that means, that you have more bees.
When they get strong enough, you can take and split them, or if you want to keep them for honey production. I was trying to increase numbers, so I took and split the strongest ones, and then I just fed my honey back to them again to make more strong hives. I'm trying to get to a certain number, and I'm just working towards that right now, but the product has made a huge difference. I haven't had to use any pharmaceuticals at all, and that's what's amazing to me, because now you have totally organic honey, too. The research that's lacking in the de facto system is all that stuff you put in the hive, it goes into the honey. Whether if you're using terramycin and any type of antibiotic, it ends up in the honey, whether if they want to admit it or not. But with this, you have a better honey product. And it's true full spectrum. That's my opinion of it.
Mm-hmm. Does the honey taste better?
I believe it does. What do you think, Will?
Oh, I think it definitely has a different taste. I mean, it doesn't taste off or anything. It has its own distinct flavor. If you really like tasting wine, you can tell wine has a...
It's just better. I just like the taste. Of course, I'm prejudiced to my own area's honey, but it does taste different to me.
But it also sounds like, though, that what you're saying is that the honey, for those of us who eat honey like myself, or the general public who purchases honey, it's actually better honey for all of us because it doesn't have the strains of the sick bee or the antibiotic and all the other stuff. It's actually passing down to us those minerals and microorganisms that you have been giving the bees. It actually makes it into our system because we eat your honey. So it makes a lot of sense to me that the end result is something all the way around more nutritious and probably taste a whole lot better, probably even last longer. So it sounds interesting. So you're excited about this. Now, when you first met Will, and Will was talking about this, Will, where were you that you were having this subject come up that Jamey heard you talking about bees and what
we
do?
We were at another meeting or on another topic, but we just happened to meet, and it was, I believe it was divinely inspired. That's all I can say, because there's no other explanation.
Me too,
for
I believe it.
It
is, yeah.
And how wonderful. And Jamey, when Will was talking about what he could do for the bees, tell us, what were you thinking at that point? Were you at a place where you would try anything, or what was it?
Basically, I was just starting to use his product or get acquainted with it, and the things he told me made just good common sense. All we're doing is introducing microorganisms that are basically extinct in the natural now because of chemtrails and all the other pharmaceuticals and the pesticides and GMO and the systemic pesticides, and there's such a long list of things that have taken away these things. Now we're just reintroducing them back into the hive. They should be able to pick these things up naturally in a regular environment, but they're not able to get them. And, it works. I mean, it's just something simple. I think everybody should look at natural approaches versus, you know, this one pill cures everything, which usually leaves you a side effect or two. It does the same thing to the bees, but using something that is supposed to be there and something that completes the organism, then that's a plus to me.
And I like that you said it just makes common sense. And I think that most people, and forgive me, I don't mean to be insulting, but most people are lacking common sense and common logic these days. I think they're just getting bombarded with all kinds of crazy, wacky ideas, and it really comes back down to really, to me, common sense. And if food and GMOs and toxicities are in our water, and they're being genetically, you know, our foods are being genetically modified to incorporate, you know, a hybrid seed that's got poison and ancient orange in it and all the rest of the stuff, it seems so obvious to me, and believe me, this is a pet peeve of mine, it seems so obvious to me that if we're eating it, we're going to get poisoned too, and we've just got to go back. So I like the idea that this worked. Now, as far as, can I ask you, and you can be totally honest, because I want people to know the truth, you were at one point, you know, had to use or were going to have to use antibiotics like other beekeepers, etc., that over time doesn't really work anyway. Would you say that what you used, the protocol that Will has, Dr. Spencer has, would you say that it was affordable financially?
Absolutely. Again, after you look at larger numbers of colonies, I imagine you could probably work a deal out on it price-wise. But it's affordable. I got it down to where I'm looking at about $2 per hive to treat. Now, that's definitely not unreasonable. The only thing is, if you get in the upper higher numbers, then, you know, it could run into something if you're looking at several thousand, because you treat more than once during the season. I like to go once a week, and that way they just have it in them or have it available. But I would say it's affordable. I'd say it's definitely in the long run. It's definitely, you cannot afford not to, in my opinion, because the other stuff just doesn't work. It's just like any other pharmaceutical out there, the stuff you use on the bees. After you use it for a while, it's not effective. These things gain a resistance towards it. Well, the neat thing about this is these parasites, things that attack the bees, cannot get a resistance to this natural substance. Basically, if it doesn't belong there, these things digest it. And I think that's a pretty awesome concept. It's basically the way God designed it to work. You know, and we've gone away from the right design and all we're thinking. I mean, it's so bad now. Look at, they just advertise on TV to tell you what you should and shouldn't take and what you should and shouldn't do. People don't even think for themselves anymore. So I think it's just back to basics is what it looks like to me.
I love it. I think it's fabulous. Now, as far as affordability, I think it's all relative. You were saying, like, if you have millions of bees, but it's all relative because those people are also making a lot more money. And in the long run, you know, that's still a percentage of what you're going to, you know, be profiting. So it sounds all relative, and then it sounds more productive. Now, with that in mind, I have a question back to Dr. Spencer. This model that you have, Will, this goes for people, pets, everything, farm animals, the whole nine yards. How many people are you being able to reach, like Jamey, to help them out with situations like colony collapse disorder, et cetera? Do you have the capability of reaching more and more people? And when you're done answering that, Jamey, I have a question for you that's similar. But go ahead, Will.
For the bees right now, we're gearing up. We can handle semi-lot loads of everything. I mean, large volume. We're just in the we've got the production down. We've got the the research down, and now we're just getting into the marketing aspect. Now, I thought I better have my sources and the ability to handle large volume first before we market.
Right.
Just good business. And then now we're just moving into the marketing stage, building the websites and getting our marketing information. It should be out in the next couple of months for the international campaign that we're going to be doing in some large publications.
Absolutely. That's fabulous. And then, Jamey, with your cell, what happened to you, have you shared it with others that raise bees as well?
Yes, I have. And usually I run into the production thing right off the bat. They want to know how much X amount is. And he's got that pretty much worked out right now. But in the beginning, that was kind of rough. I don't know. I mean, I really want to see this stuff go out. Beekeepers are just like anything else. I mean, they're almost like their own little society. You talk to another beekeeper, you pretty much know you have a friend there.
Right on. And I get what you're saying. When we come back, let's talk about that. Let's talk about that unifying amongst farmers and beekeepers. You're listening to The Truth Denied Talk Radio. This is Roxy Lopez. We'll be right back. Welcome back to The Truth Denied, and of course it's Monday, acting like a Friday. I want to say thank you to our wonderful producer, Adam. He's a sweetie, and we just love him at American Freedom Radio. It's just rocking here. Anyway, we are with Dr. Wil Spencer, and of course, farmer and beekeeper Jamey Behringer. So Jamey, you were just talking about the whole concept of, you know, healing your bees, and in the long run, how necessary that is, and how it all works out, and then about sharing this idea of the microorganisms that are not in nature with other beekeepers, and have you been successful once you can get? I guess once you get past the monetary amount. I guess that's what I'm surmising.
Well, it's not so much that, but everyone that I talk to that knows the bees well always want to know how do they look after the second year. And that's usually the pretty critical time. Most anything, it happens in a cycle like that. Like the Varroa mites, it takes usually a couple years for them to actually kill the bees off. So essentially, I'm waiting for this time period to end here, but I do have several lined up, and I have talked to about it, and they seem very interested, and I'm going to make some connections there with Will. I don't think it's going to be a problem at all. I truly believe in this product. That's how me and Will became friends, because everything he tells me about this is true. I mean, I witnessed it with my own eyes, and I like people that tell the truth, so that's very important to me. And I don't want to exaggerate anything, but I haven't seen anything like it, especially something as totally natural as it. And I think people can identify that, and they can see that.
Right.
Not too much truth out there in the mainstream at all. Everything is mainly a distraction. But once you get past all that and you get down to the nuts and bolts, usually you're looking at 2 years. Well, this fall I can say, hey, I've been doing this for a couple of years, and these are my results. And most beekeepers, the first question they ask, what's your losses like? Now, when I can say, you know, I've been able to retain in the high 90% and keeping the bees year to year, that's a pretty attractive thing. If that happens again this year, I mean, that's pretty much the litmus test as far as I'm concerned. And everybody want to jump on board because now you're not looking at making up winter losses. Now you're not looking at having to do more splits to make up for hives you don't have. And that's time, and time is money to anybody, especially if you have a beekeeping operation, because you could be doing other things to improve your operation besides trying to make up for lost ground. So that's the most attractive thing right there about it, is that the bees are alive and the bees are doing well. And when they're doing well, they're out there pollinating. And we need more bees. We have less bees than we did many years ago, and we have more crops to be pollinated with those bees. And so it's just a mix for disaster. There's so many things that you cannot have without a pollinator, like a bee. Just something as simple as a cucumber. Any type of a cucurbit, they have to have, it has a sticky pollen. It has to have a bee go down in there and get that sticky pollen on himself, or herself, excuse me, go to another flower and pollinate it, or else it won't happen. That's just the design of it, and there's many other things that are like that. So they're extremely important, and I consider it an honor to even be able to work them.
Right. Oh, and how wonderful that is that you say that. You know, I want to share with the audience a really quick story about bees that I had read. And folks, not only do we need bees, I mean, they are essential. They are an essential part of agriculture. They are an essential part of this world. They're very, very instrumental. I can't imagine a world without them. And I can't imagine why anybody would want a world without them. I learned that bees work certain types of the year to pollinate, and then they take a break because of all the hard work that they do. And I found out that several years ago out of California, and it makes me want to cry. But beekeepers, obviously ones that don't have a heart, were selling or lending, leasing bees to another country. And I won't mention the other country. I'm not going to do that right now. But the other country was buying these bees and then working them in the off season of the bees that were here in the United States. And so they started to have problems right away because the bees were dying, because they were enslaved. They were working all year round and then just dying off. They couldn't do it. The bees couldn't do it. So back to, you know, these bright ideas that big agriculture has. Why won't agriculture or the those who are behind agriculture, even the commercial farmers, why won't they get behind going back to the way it was? That it actually is cheaper in the long run than being a slave to Monsanto, let's say, and having to purchase seeds every single year. I mean, where did we go wrong, and how do we go back? Gentlemen, I'd like you to really tell me what the solution is, because I stand with you on this.
It's not the farmers. It's the policymakers and those that lobby and pay for policy to be passed. That's the problem. It's not.
So are the farmers also? Are you also prisoners of this?
Well, you got to look at it this way. You have to follow the money, and when you follow that trail, you realize that it's all about profit. If they can take and raise things in monocrops and get a big bumper crop, and then they can bump that price up, they're making a killing. And then they subsidize things, they take our money, and they repump it back into the system just so they can keep a floated price at a certain level. And they'll do anything to protect that profit center. They'll market, they'll run expensive commercials, they'll tell you that this is good for you, that's good for anything, just to sell the stuff. And the cheaper they can make it, the better it is for them. In some cases, I've seen honey that's not even truly honey. They're taking lactose, and they're feeding it to the bees, and they're making that into honey. Then they're adding things to it. They've actually redefined what honey actually is. So some of the stuff you're getting in the stores is just garbage. Other beekeepers, and I know some big ones, they'll get ADM to tank in great big tankers of genetically modified corn syrup, and they'll feed that to the bees, and then they'll wonder why they die.
Oh, my Lord.
It's the same
thing.
No, I mean,
I had no
we
idea.
We can't take it, and they're even weaker than what we are. So it shows up really quick in them. But it's all about the money. These people are ruthless. They don't care about life at all. It's just a profit center.
And, so are they putting a lot of you out of business as well?
Well, that was the push back when I was in it the first time. Either get really big and do a lot of production or just get out of it. Basically, what they were trying to do is just corner the market on it so that way they could raise the price back up. And they did it by dumping the price at first. But then after a lot of people started getting out of it and then they started getting into it, they raised the price back up again. So it's just like you see the same kind of pattern in mortgages and loans and 401ks. It's just, it's all out there. But it's just like the same game just played in a different board. It's sad and predictable, but I think the only way out of it is for people just to wake up and say enough's enough. And I know I'm kind of sticking my neck out by doing this, but, you know, I don't know of any other way to do it. The other way does not work. It's more frustration than when you're done. The end of the product isn't even worth consuming yourself. So I would say that the best way to do it is just get back to basics and just educate people and teach them that, you know, this is the way it's supposed to be, and this is what works.
Now, Jamey, you were saying a little earlier in the show, you'd mentioned that beekeepers and farmers, you guys are comrades because you have a lot in common. So can you all unify? I mean, is there a way to do that, to unify against these ridiculous laws and these ridiculous, I mean, I understand.
I believe there is, but we do have a problem within that. It's just like any other organization. As soon as you start getting memberships, beekeeping associations, state beekeepers, and all these different types of organizations, they get infiltrated. And then you get people in there that have a flattering tongue and they can talk really well, and they get everybody bickering about something that really doesn't mean anything. You know, similar to our system that we have, Republican, Democrat, you know, it's just a horse and pony show. So you go to these meetings, you do learn things mostly just by talking to each other, interacting in between the speakers, because that end of it all leans towards the pharmaceutical ends, and we're getting this, we're doing that, but there are pockets of them. But I believe that when you find, or when we're able to identify to everybody that this product does do what we say it does, that more people, word of mouth is very powerful, and that's the best advertisement. And when you stand on the truth, well, that's a pretty powerful combination right there. So,
and the truth is in the results, isn't it? And the integrity of the individuals involved. And I do understand in any form of environmental activism whatsoever, I am seeing it all around me. There are infiltrators, like you said. I can't believe you said that it's even going on with farmers. I don't know why I didn't know that myself. But, yeah, that makes sense. And then you've got somebody who infiltrates and then sort of drags everybody in another direction. And before you know it, you're on that wheel again, going around and around and around and around. I also want to say to you too, you know, thank you, Wil Spencer, for what you do, and thank you, Jamey, for stepping up to the plate and saying, you know what, I'm done. You know, we've got to start getting out to the world, and letting people know about this, and thank you for, you know, the people that you're trying to turn on to get empowered. This is a big picture. I mean, food consumption is our one of our biggest single most necessities, food.
Yes.
I mean, humans can't live without food. Nothing can live without food. So, I mean, it's huge. But, you know, I think the oil industry, you know, is the poster child for the models that all these other corporations have used. It's that whole, you know, oh, look, we don't have any, and we don't have any more. Oh, look, we're running out. Raise the price, raise the price, raise the price. And it looks like it's the model for everything in this country.
I agree. I mean, it does look that way.
Supply and demand, but let's fudge the numbers on both ends. And, you know, people, you know, the general public doesn't know what's coming and going. But from what you're saying regarding being a farmer, there is integrity to that. And there's a lot of work involved in that. And I would think that most farmers who work with produce, at least, or animals, you've got a knowledge base that has been bred out of this country. You've got a knowledge base. I mean, you know, I'd say 9 out of 10 people don't even know how to grow tomatoes in their backyard, more or less have a farm.
That's right. We've been disconnected from the earth. People don't even know how to do that. They don't even know what it takes to do something like that. And if there's anything that one person could do, and I would say just take if you don't have a rototiller, take a shovel, turn some soil, grow some plants, and get reconnected back to that. If everybody did that, it would create an awareness. And if you want, get a book. There's a lot of them out there. And get yourself a colony of bees and raise them yourself and see what it's like. It's a very gratifying experience, and it's well worth the time. I can't think of anything that would be better to do on a nice summer day than work the bees and work in the garden. It's better than sitting and watching TV, because that just doesn't do anything but dumb you down. This here, you can actually learn, and it's different every year. It's not the same old grind, and it's a very enjoyable experience. You can do it as a hobby. You don't got to do it as a living. But that's what they don't want. They don't want people out there doing that, because then you're aware, and they certainly don't want that.
What is, you know, you said the word gratifying. What's the most gratifying for you? Obviously, that your bees aren't sick anymore. That must be a real joy. It definitely touches my heart. And what's your favorite part about this? What has this done for your life? Because you sound pretty happy, and at the same time, you sound like you want everyone to know about this, and then you sound, you know, there's a hint of anger, and just like with Will, and like myself, there is a hint of anger that we don't all get to partake in this. So what's your favorite part about your bees being healthy again, and the whole idea of being a beekeeper? What's your favorite part?
I'd say the favorite part is going out into that yard and opening things up and not finding problems. It used to be when I'd open them up, I'd find problems. It was either a problem with mold overgrowth, or it was a problem with equipment, you know, going into foul brood, or it was a problem with bees being sick or diarrhea. It's just so many different things. But when you open the hive up and that sweet smell is there, the population is good, the bees are all doing their jobs, they're healthy, they're not malformed, everything looks good, they almost shine, you know. And that's my favorite part, when I open up and see that. And then when I look out and I see the flowers. And just since I've had them here, the flowers have doubled in this area. And it just makes such a difference, because the flowers are more full. There's more of them. It's almost like a carpet instead of being sporadically placed around. It's better for the trees. There's just so many things. But I'd say that's my favorite part, just opening up and not getting disappointed. Yeah,
right. I bet you that was stressful every time you opened it up and saw another problem and another problem that you're trying to solve all the time.
It was now, disheartening. What, it was.
I bet.
You just felt like you was in a room and you didn't have enough air, and I didn't know what to do. And I thought, well, we can do what everybody else is doing, and
right.
Then I met Will. I didn't have to go down that path. And,
and then you met Will. Okay, when we get back, which is a great way to and we'll be ending the show on the after the next break, and I want to ask what every American citizen can do about this bee problem. I've got a specific question for you, and you're listening to The Truth Denied Talk Radio. This is Roxy Lopez. We'll be right back. What can we do as individual, let's say, homeowners that have property? What can we do, or what should we not be doing to help the bees that come through our yards?
Well, bees live in colonies, so you'd almost have to find where the source was. And what I would say is treat them, get the product on them. Find your local beekeepers, identify to them that there is a product to use. Just your average person in the yard, there's not much you can do for them. Unless you want to get the product yourself, what you could do is put it out on a broad-spectrum feeder and then just feed it to them yourself. But only the field bees would get it, and some would get it in the hive, too. But the best is to get it right to the hive.
So how would we find locally? So what you're saying is, like, for instance, the bees that I'm seeing in my yard and the ones that are drowning, or the ones that are falling, you know, with broken backs and all the rest of it, are you saying that they're coming from a hive in the area?
There's a good chance. Well, they're definitely coming from a hive, but whether if it's a hive in captivity,
that's what I meant.
Hive in the wild, you'd have to determine that. There's a couple of different ways you can do it. You can take anise oil, and you can put a little bit out, and the bees will come down to it, and then just watch where they fly and then follow them. Just keep repeating that process till you find the location of the hive. There's also pheromones, different things you can use on the market. I'd say the best thing that people can do, and again, this is going back to basics, I'd say is just start being aware. Turn your soil. Get out there in your bare feet into the dirt and just stand there in the dirt, because that's good for you, too. It takes negative energy or negative electricity out of your body. And that's something Will told me about, and I've tried it, and it does work. Just try to get back to natural, basic things. And if you hear anybody talking about bees, inject that. There is an answer out there, and it does work. That would be my advice to anybody, is just get involved. Don't be afraid to get involved.
Excellent. And during the break, Dr. Spencer was talking about, I want you to tell that story real quick, that the 25 hives that were dying. Can you tell that story live to our listeners?
Sure. I had contacted a beekeeper a while ago. He responded to a broad email I sent out. Anyhow, he had 25 hives that were going to die. He had 2,000 hives, and this was about two springs ago. And he was responding to the email I had sent, and he said he'd like to try it. So I told him, well, just give me your worst hives, the ones you're going to die anyhow in the spring from coming out of winter. And he had 25 of them. He said, just tell me how to use it. So I came to his place, went to his place, and gave him the product. All 25 hives lived. All 25 hives went on to pollinate apples and pears. And he also pulled, it was like 70 or 100 pounds, between 70 and 100 pounds of honey off each of the hives at the end of the year. Mm. That was amazing. I mean, they were going to die anyhow. So for $2, well, it was $2 a treatment per hive. He treated it, I think, like three or four times. He did not have any problems with those. He didn't have to replace those bees. Plus, he made money with them.
Wow, and I bet you now, when this happens to a beekeeper, have they been experiencing problems for a long time? For instance, Jamey, has it been years that you were experiencing problems with bees and sort of got to the place where you even want to just give up?
Oh yeah, definitely. We got to that point here about 20 years ago, and I got out of it. It just got to the point that the partnership I was in, I wasn't getting enough on my end to be able to raise my family and everything, so I had to get into a different trade, and he got out of it, and it's a sad story. He basically took his own life. He ended up getting on the pharmaceutical stuff, and it didn't work for him, and he's no longer with us. So, and it's just a real tragic thing there, how that all panned out. But
that's terrible. I'm sorry to hear that. You know,
it's just the way it is, I guess, but. You know, he wasn't around, you know, to see it, you know, come full circle. But he always wanted to try to do things natural, too, but he just didn't really know. But, I mean, there's always been things attacking, you know, and I think it's more now because they're doing more, they're messing with the environment more. But back then it was mainly the mites. That was the biggest thing. But, again, you're looking at why are they being attacked, because nature attacks things that are sick and dying. Basically, the bees were compromised. So these parasites, that's what they eat. They eat things that are dying. And then these things colonize within the hive, like the varroa, to actually get into the brood. And they just raise havoc. And that's just one thing. But, yeah, it's always been a little something here, a little something there. American foul brood, European foul brood is another two problems. But with this product, we can put in the powder, and it eats the mold, and it eats the pathogens and anything that would hurt the bees, and it just cleans it up. So they don't have to spend all that time trying to eat that mold themselves and digest it and lose all that life. This product does it for them. So all those bees and thousands of them that it would take to just clean up a few frames of moldy combs now can go out and be productive and bring in nectar. And they don't have to clean the stuff up themselves.
How long does a bee live?
Well, that depends, you know. I mean, average is 6 to 8 weeks, you know, in the summertime. They live a little longer in the winter, but they have a different job each stage of their life. And they're in it for a few days, up to a week here and there, and then it just works, and then they end up as a guard bee towards the end, and then they just work in the field until they die.
So their lifespan is 6 weeks?
6 to 8 weeks, yeah. That's norm.
So
she lives much longer. She can actually live years.
Okay.
But that's another thing. You know, most beekeepers that I've talked to that are doing well, they're requeening sometimes twice a year. you know, to get that right queen. But what I'm experiencing, when I put this in, I get the product in there, I'm not having to requeen like that. And that's a huge savings right there. If you don't have to requeen your hives as often and you're still getting the results, well, that should command attention just in itself. And I believe it's a Rubik's Cube, just like anything else. We're going to find more and more positive things here as time goes on. But the results that I'm seeing, you know, just, I'm just amazed. I just am amazed at the simplicity of it. And it's simple enough that an average guy like me can use it. And I use the product. I use it on myself, too. And I would say the best thing that anybody could do, you know, is dig the dirt. You know, use the product on your plants, because you're going to get it in your body that way. You're going to get twice the root growth, twice the foliage, and twice the oil potency in your plants. You won't get anything like that in your organic stores. So you're going to have that, and you're going to have the experience of working the soil. Use the products yourself. You're going to get your mineral deficiencies and everything taken care of. You're going to feel better. I feel 20 years younger than when I felt before.
Well, you sure do sound energetic, and so does Will. And, you know, I want to thank you.
I mean, it makes a huge difference. If I miss that taking my minerals, one day I notice it. But then I take them, and I just feel energetic. My mind is clear. I can think better. And I'm able to do things and plan. Sometimes I get overloaded, but, you know, I guess that can happen to anybody. But use the products yourself. And if you feel bull, get yourself a hive and use the products on the hive, too. I mean, I would rather see 10,000 people after keeping one hive than one guy keeping 10,000. Because if you're in a commercial operation, you have over 500 hives. You cannot give the personal attention to that hive that it needs. You can't watch it. You can't get in there and check everything. And it's just, you're not doing the job right when you start getting high numbers. But if you have one or two hives yourself, you can go out there and get into them more often. You know what's going on with them. If they start to go a certain direction, you can get in there and help them. And I just think it'd be a great thing.
Absolutely, and I thank you for that. Thank you both for coming to the show. Sure. As well. We're going to wrap it up. We've got a couple more minutes. Will, anything else that you want to let everybody know? I know you're at bodyelectrician.com, and we did talk about a section called Healthy Diet. As far as contacting you, you have contact. We'll get that up on a video. And then as far as contacting you, Jamey, if we can probably have them go through Wil Spencer, is that all right?
That'd be great. If there's anybody out there that has a lot of hives and they want to talk to somebody who's kept a lot of hives before, I can talk that way too. I'd be more than glad to answer any questions. My time's kind of limited here and there. Right now I'm kind of under the gun. Went out today, looked in my hives, and I got to build another 35 boxes, like right now.
They're
just spending that much, so, and most of them have two or three on it right now. So, and that's just starting from a basic box. Not even a month and a half ago. So I'm ecstatic. I don't have no problem doing boxes other than just taking the time.
Well, that's wonderful. And again, you want to go to Body Electrician for all this stuff, for the microorganisms, for just about anything. Will, thanks for coming up to the show. Jamey, thank you so much. And you're listening to The Truth Denied Talk Radio. I'm Roxy Lopez. Have a great week.
No rules, no rules, no taboo topics, no taboo topics, no fear of doom, no fear of doom. We are American Freedom Radio, American Freedom Radio.